JKP Audio, an imprint of Jessica Kingsley Publishers, presents DBT for Everyone, a guide to the perks, pitfalls, and possibilities of DBT for better mental health, by Kate Sherman and Michelle Henderson. Read by Kristin Atherton. To my professor, Jerry Saltzman, the only reason I finished grad school, and also to my clients, our listeners, and you, K.S. To Adam and Noah, for giving me the greatest gifts I could ever ask for, and to my clients, past and present, for teaching me more about healing and growth than any book ever could. M.H. Michelle's Preface. Dialectical Behaviour Therapy, DBT, was not designed for someone like me. DBT was created for people who hurt themselves and have anger outbursts. DBT was made for those who have poor impulse control and addictive behaviours. I've never self-harmed in my life, and the thought of yelling at someone or throwing something when I'm angry makes my heart beat faster with trepidation. I don't do anything in my life impulsively, thinking every choice through at length before I act. So how do I find myself writing a book about DBT? What is it about DBT that appeals to me and works for me? I first came to DBT in 2011, when I worked at a group home. I was fresh out of college with my bachelor's degree in psychology and excited to find some work in my field. So I took a job at a group home, making $10 an hour, working with girls who were suicidal, sexually aggressive, and physically assaultive. These girls had been kicked out of foster homes over and over again, and if I told you their stories, your heart would break. These girls had been through some serious shit. Once a week, all six of them piled into a minivan and we went to a two-hour DBT group. This became the night of work I looked forward to the most. I had never heard of DBT before, and I was fascinated. It was something concrete and tangible to do, and I was a sucker for a good worksheet. I learned the skills right along with them and helped them with their homework. I led them in mindfulness activities before dinner as part of their DBT practice and started to understand the skills pretty well. But once I enrolled in graduate school a year later, I stopped working at the group home and put DBT out of my mind. I wouldn't return to it until I did my internship a couple years later. The agency that took me on for my internship, where I would eventually get hired and work with my co-author Kate, wanted to reboot their DBT program, and I was an intern with time on my hands and hours of requirements to fulfill. So I started leading groups. Now I find myself years later still leading groups and loving it. But what about me? Sure, I learned about DBT and I teach DBT, but according to many, I am not bad enough to actually need DBT skills. There is still a major stereotype that exists about who DBT is meant for, and it isn't me. I am a perfectionist and have a strong type A personality. I run my own business and have a happy, healthy marriage. But for those of you who are like me, you know there is a lot going on underneath the surface when you function this well. Your brain never quits. You're constantly second-guessing and criticizing yourself. You crave structure in order to feel like you have control over your world, but you also hate how rigid you've become. Just because you're not breaking down on the outside doesn't mean you're not struggling intensely to keep up. And you know what? DBT can help. Mindfulness is absolutely essential to having any kind of balance in life instead of constantly checking things off a to-do list. When life throws a curveball at you, distress tolerance skills provide much-needed guidance to cope instead of trying to control or fix it, as I'm prone to doing. While you may be very good at keeping your emotions in check and not losing your shit, emotion regulation can truly be a godsend in helping you notice what you're feeling in the first place. And though you may have overall healthy relationships in your life, if you're afraid to rock the boat and actually talk about your needs, interpersonal effectiveness has you covered. So yes, DBT is for us too. DBT has changed my life. It has helped me slow down, be more flexible, and become authentic. My hope is that you will be kind to yourself as you learn and practice DBT. You will not do it all perfectly, and you don't need to. I am proud of you for taking this step towards true self-care. Kate's preface. Unlike Michelle, DBT was designed for someone like me. When I was 19 years old, I stood in a puddle of blood in my bathroom after a particularly bad bout of self-harm. Looking at myself in the mirror, I thought, if I don't get help, I'm going to accidentally kill myself. That moment was the beginning of my personal journey with DBT. Shortly after that day, I started treatment at what was then the DBT Center of Seattle. It was a gold standard DBT program, so I attended a 2-hour group every week, as well as weekly sessions with an individual DBT therapist. The group portion was a 9-month commitment. I think I worked with that DBT therapist for about an additional year before moving on. It was quite literally a life-changing experience. I'm not exaggerating at all when I say I believe DBT saved my life. I learned skills to help me tolerate and moderate my own emotions better. I discovered ways to ground myself back into the here and now, and back to what was real. I was given tools to help me set better boundaries and have healthier relationships. Despite the monumental impact it had on me, I didn't think much about DBT for many years after I went through the program. Most of the skills had become something I knew and used, but rarely thought of in explicit DBT language. I didn't even think of it much while going through school for counselling psychology, where I was reminded of it in classes and textbooks. Then I started work in community mental health, and met Michelle. Shortly after we met, we started leading groups together. This reignited in me a passion for these skills. Teaching DBT skills to others and seeing them have the impact on their lives that they had on my life so many years ago was incredibly fulfilling. That time was also the start of a relationship that now plays a central role in my personal and professional life. What began as a tentative colleague relationship grew into a treasured friendship. 6 years and counting of leading groups together, 2 podcasts, and now, this book. While no book could possibly replace the immersive experience of a full-fledged DBT program or skills group, my hope for this book is the same hope I have for the members of every group we lead or the listeners of every podcast we release. That it helps make someone's life better and helps you, dear listener, live with more ease. I hope my experience, not only as a teacher of DBT, but as a previous student, will help me present the skills in an accessible and intuitive fashion. I hope you learn skills here to help you through the dark times and find healthier ways to take care of yourself. I hope you find in DBT some measure of what I found, a set of skills that changed my life for the better. Introduction. While our personal histories with DBT started within the past two decades, DBT itself is much older. DBT was developed in the 1970s at the University of Washington in Seattle by Dr. Marcia Linehan, a clinical psychologist. She created DBT originally to treat borderline personality disorder, BPD, a disorder at the time that was considered untreatable by many in the psychology community. Since its creation, innumerable research studies have been done on DBT, and it has been found to be effective for a wide array of issues beyond BPD. DBT programs are structured around four modules, with accompanying worksheets to complete. We formatted our book similarly into four parts corresponding with each of the four DBT modules. The most common worksheets used, and the ones we reference in this book, were created by Linehan herself. Besides very different personal introductions to DBT, as we mentioned in our prefaces, there are a lot of ways in which we differ from each other. Kate walks barefoot everywhere, including in public. Michelle wasn't allowed outside without shoes as a child, and so is rarely ever barefoot. Kate dyes her hair myriad colours. Michelle has never dyed her hair. While Michelle is organised and scheduled, Kate is more scattered and impulsive. The list could go on. When we first met in community mental health, we didn't think we would ever become close friends, let alone go on to start two podcasts together and write this book. We've come to see over the years that our differences actually make us a perfect fit as colleagues and friends. DBT is all about dialectics, and the dialectic for the two of us is that we are very different and also very similar in meaningful ways. We both are quite talkative, while also being attentive listeners. No surprise we became therapists. We've experienced challenging relationships and found understanding in each other. We hold very similar values. When we were approached to write this book, we both thought, why us? After all, there are DBT books already on the market. What could we add to the mix? But the answer came to us almost immediately. We have our different personalities and experiences to share. Neither of us thought when we launched our podcast, DBT and Me, that it would grow as much as it has. People benefit from learning the skills, sure, but what we hear repeatedly is how much people benefit from our personal sharing and our dynamic together as we talk about DBT. We have fun while we do it. We laugh while we do it, and for us, it hardly ever feels like work. A big thing we have in common is that we genuinely enjoy teaching these skills to other people and using them ourselves. That's what we hope to bring to this book. There are a number of different ways you may want to approach the material presented here. If this is your first exposure to the skills, we highly recommend that you listen to the book through, start to finish, in the order presented. That said, if you know you really need distress tolerance skills, or perhaps your therapist has suggested you look into a particular set of skills, you can skip around in the book, listening to it in the order that feels most relevant to you. After you've listened through all the skills, or if you're coming to this book for more of a refresher after already going through a DBT course, you can use the index to look up a skill you're struggling with, or to find a skill you're wanting to utilise. Ultimately, approach it as it feels and works best for you. In each chapter, you'll hear both of our unique perspectives. After you listen about what the skill is, you'll hear tips from us both. We will then talk about potential pitfalls of the skill and potential benefits of using it. We end each chapter with questions for you to answer about how you see that skill fitting into your life. Above all, we want you to actually integrate what you're listening to by going out and using these skills. We both believe wholeheartedly that DBT is not perfect and it can be extremely helpful and life-changing. We think DBT is here for everyone, no matter how big or small your life challenges are. We are grateful for you joining us, and we are honoured to be a part of your mental health journey. Part 1. Mindfulness. Mindfulness skills help you stay present, enjoy your day-to-day life, and make choices that better serve your well-being. Mindfulness is foundational for DBT and woven into all of the different modules. Chapter 1. Wise Mind. Reason Mind, Emotion Mind. About this skill. We believe wholeheartedly that wise mind is one of the most important skills to learn, and also one of the most difficult to practice consistently. That is why wise mind is the first skill we teach in every group, and it's the first skill we're talking about here in this book. Learning how to access wise mind takes continual effort. Even though it's not easy to use wise mind, when you are able to enter a wise mind state, the results can be life-changing. Human beings have different areas of the brain that manage decision-making. There is a part, the frontal lobe, that is more focused on reason, i.e. logic, organisation, objectivity, etc., and a part, the amygdala, that is focused on emotion, i.e. creativity, intuition, subjectivity, etc. There are strengths and weaknesses to both. The reason part, also called reasonable or rational mind, does a good job of helping you accomplish tasks and think about potential consequences before taking action, while the emotion part helps you form relationships with others through giving and receiving emotional expression. You need both in your life, and will run into challenges when you rely too much on one side over the other. If you err too much on the reason side, you will become too focused on your goals, proving you are right, and getting things done at the expense of neglecting your own needs and those you care about. If you go too far to the emotion side, you may behave impulsively, and sometimes say or do things that hurt other people, or get you into trouble because you didn't think first. We believe everyone is prone to falling more to one side or the other when it comes to processing information and making choices. When reason mind and emotion mind come together, the blending of the two is called wise mind. Wise mind takes the best qualities of both sides and brings them together. Some people describe their wise mind as a feeling of being in touch with a higher power or higher self. Some people think of it as an inner knowing or a powerful, strong intuition about what feels right for them. Oftentimes, when people find their wise mind, they experience a sense of relief or a feeling of peace come over them. Being in a wise mind state is going to look different for everyone, but we hope you find yourself feeling balanced, present, and at ease when you're able to access both your emotional and reasonable parts at the same time. We all have wisdom inside us, waiting to be accessed. Kate's tips. Wise mind is an essential part of DBT, and it's also one of my favourites. Thinking back to when I was a client in a DBT program, I remember being asked questions every week like, were you in your wise mind? Or, what would your wise mind say? Of all the skills, I think wise mind was brought up the most consistently. As you continue your journey through this book, and through the rest of the skills, I hope you will keep this skill at the forefront of your mind. It makes just about every other skill easier and more effective. Emotion mind. Personally, I spend most of my life in emotion mind. At its most mild, this may look like following my heart a little more than my head. At its most helpful/positive, this looks like showing up for my clients with compassion, empathy, and warmth. At its worst or most destructive, this looks like self-harm, throwing things, and other forms of lashing out or falling apart. I hope this demonstrates that emotion mind is far from being all bad. Emotion mind can encompass a lot of love, passion, and creativity. Our culture is prone to belittling emotion mind, seeing it as associated with femininity and therefore as lesser and weak. This is simply inaccurate, or at the very least, incomplete. While there is destructive potential in emotion mind, there's also a tremendous capacity for creation. Reason mind. While I am often led by my heart, there are activities and events that require me to lean more heavily on my reason mind. If I'm trying to hang drywall, work my way through a math problem, or learn how to repair a piece of electronics, I want to be in my reason mind. Just like emotion mind, reason mind can look very different at different times. It can range from keeping a cool head in an emergency to being coldly logical and withdrawn emotionally from a partner. Just as I said that emotion mind isn't all bad, I'd like to fight societal bias by saying reason mind isn't all good. Logic is associated with masculinity in our culture and considered superior. However, there are places, times, and situations where you need your emotions to show up, and where being only logical will damage you and your relationships. Wise mind. One of the main questions we get when we run DBT groups is, how do I find wise mind? For me, wise mind is all about a feeling. No matter what emotions I'm going through at the time, when I make a wise mind decision, there's a sense of a weight being lifted, of peace, of rightness. I may be angry or grieving or 100 other things, but through it all sings this sense of rightness. I then remember what this rightness feels like in my body, so I can also tell when I'm not in my wise mind. It simply won't feel right. This is more about big decisions than everyday choices, but the same kind of sensation is there even for the smaller stuff. It's just more subdued. For the smaller choices, I really have to get quiet and listen to myself to feel that sense of rightness. Nevertheless, if the choice I'm making aligns with my wise mind, that sensation is there. It is in looking for that feeling that I'm most able to find and get into my wise mind. Michelle's tips. Understanding wise mind and being able to find it are two different things. For many years, when I led DBT groups, I taught what wise mind was, but I didn't really talk about how to get there because I didn't know myself. It was only through my own work in therapy and my therapist helping me cultivate the idea of a wise adult self that I came to know my own wise mind. Emotion mind. When we boil it down, our emotion mind is all about what we feel. I prioritize and value my emotions highly. I'm an avid journaler, getting everything I think and feel out onto the page when I write. I am also an external processor, meaning I want to verbalize what I'm feeling. Maybe it comes from Cancer being my astrological sign, but I live in a world where I spend a considerable amount of time talking about and being with my emotions. When I'm in my emotion mind too much, I get preoccupied with how strongly I'm feeling my emotions, and it can be hard for me to take a break from thinking about painful emotional experiences. If you're like me, it's incredibly important to not only have an outlet for your emotions, like a journal or trusted friend, but to also know when to take a break from thinking about what's causing you emotional distress. Reason mind. My reason mind looks very much like doing mind, which will be discussed in the next chapter. Organization and to-do lists feel like breathing to me. I can be very persistent, and I work at things until they are complete, often to my detriment. I'm also quite analytical and like to know the rationale behind decisions and why people do what they do. When I am too much in my reason mind, I become solely focused on the task or issue in front of me, and I neglect to pause and check in with myself about my needs. I have found it necessary to build in breaks, just like with emotion mind. Wise mind. I am in my wise mind when I pause. When I'm there, I ask myself, what do I need? And is this serving me? Those questions help me tap into self-care and make decisions that honour my emotional experience and slow me down when I'm trying to get too much done at once. Here are my favourite strategies when it comes to finding your wise mind. Tip 1. Find your wise adult self. Think about a time when you made a decision that served you and was beneficial for your life. This may be a big decision, like a career change or leaving an unhealthy relationship, or a small decision, deciding to take a walk or talk to a friend. As you think about these things, imagine who you were when you made that choice. What age were you? How did you look? What were your thoughts and emotions at the time? When you're able to pause and reflect on past wise mind decisions you've made, you're creating a relationship with the part of you that made those choices. You can think of that part as your wise adult, and you can return to thinking about this part when you're facing challenging decisions in the future. Because I have worked on this extensively with my own therapist, she will often say to me in sessions to close my eyes and imagine my wise adult. I then pause and listen to what my wise adult says about a situation and find clarity. Tip 2. Ask what someone else would do. If it's too difficult for you to think about wise mind decisions you've made in the past, think about someone you believe embodies the traits of wise mind. This could be someone you know or a fictional character. This person could be living or dead. Imagine them standing before you and have a dialogue with them about what you're struggling with. Ask them questions and see what answers you receive. Think about what they would do or what guidance they could provide. Tip 3. Find a mantra. Having a go-to phrase can really help with finding wise mind. For me, I commonly will say, let it be. Or I'll listen to the song by the Beatles, and it nearly always does the trick to bring me to my wise mind. You can even just pick a singular word, such as patience, trust, acceptance, or pause. If you repeat your mantra or word enough, especially if you take an intentional breath as you do so, you'll notice a shift in how your body is feeling physically. And this will likely change your thinking to a more wise mind direction. Pitfalls. Pitfall 1. One of the most common mistakes folks make is thinking that wise mind is equal parts emotion mind and reason mind. While this may be true some of the time, it's certainly not necessary. Different situations are going to call for being more in your emotion mind or your reason mind. Because a part of wise mind is being effective, make sure you're leaning more towards whichever side the situation requires. Just because we use the word balanced to describe wise mind does not mean it's a balance composed of equal parts. It's more like the balance of someone walking a high wire. In order to keep their balance, they sometimes need to lean more one way or more the other. That's the kind of balance we're talking about when we describe wise mind. Pitfall 2. Another common misconception about wise mind is believing the goal is to be in your wise mind all day, every day. While that would probably feel pretty good, we strongly believe it's an unattainable goal. It sets the bar far too high and guarantees you'll be failing far more than you succeed. Rather than living in your wise mind 24/7, start by setting the bar at being in your wise mind at least once a week, or maybe once a day. Set the bar somewhere you can reach it. Humans are far more motivated by success than by failure, so set yourself up to succeed. It'll keep you coming back to your wise mind rather than causing you to avoid it because you associate it with feelings of failure or shame. Pitfall 3. People often believe that a wise mind decision will always feel good, comfortable, or easy. Sadly, this just isn't true. Nearly everyone has been in a situation where the right or wise mind decision was terrifying and or painful. For instance, you might know that ending your long-term relationship is the wise mind thing to do, but that doesn't mean it won't be painful and frightening to leave. While it's common to find a sense of peace when reaching a wise mind decision, that peace doesn't eradicate every other uncomfortable feeling that may be there. Listen to / feel for a sense of rightness, but don't wait to find a choice that's not emotionally difficult. There might not be one. Benefits. Benefit 1. Spending too much time in emotion mind or reason mind leaves you clinging tightly to your experience. Someone in their emotion mind believes strongly that their emotion reflects reality. For example, I'm scared of this, therefore it must be dangerous. Someone in reason mind gets caught up in research, facts, and trying to prove a point. When you are in your wise mind, you let go of the need to prove others wrong or justify yourself. You may feel settled and calm, seeing the big picture of what you're experiencing in a larger context. Wise mind is about seeing the entire forest, not just a single tree. Benefit 2. At its core, anxiety is worry about the future and things you can't control. Wise mind helps you come back to the present and focus on what you can do. If you're able to pause and notice anxiety early on, getting into your wise mind might prevent a panic attack. It can help you communicate more calmly with those around you, because you'll feel calmer yourself. Benefit 3. Everyone holds some beliefs or commits some actions that don't work very well for them. These may be things you learned from your parents or caregivers in early childhood, or things you started doing after experiencing a trauma. Unhealthy coping mechanisms and reactions can take hold of your life and leave you with regrets and shame later on. Wise mind can break you out of ruts and lead you to change course in your life. When you're contemplating making a change, or you realize something is damaging your life, this is a perfect time to find your wise mind and make a new choice. Exercise. Write down your thoughts and feelings in response to the following questions. When you think about reason mind or emotion mind, which do you identify with the most? How have you seen this show up in your daily life? Where do you think you'll struggle most with the concepts of reason mind or emotion mind? How can you imagine this skill being useful to you in your life? How can you see yourself implementing it? Chapter 2. Wise mind. Doing mind, being mind. About this skill. Another way to conceptualize wise mind is to think of it as the intersection between doing and being. Incorporating aspects of both reason and emotion can be thought of as finding mental and emotional balance with decision-making, whereas practicing both doing and being reflects a balance with how you spend your time and energy. When you catch yourself doing either too much or not enough, accessing your wise mind is extremely beneficial. If you identify as a procrastinator, you'll benefit from bringing in your doing mind. If you are a workaholic or perfectionist, you'll benefit from finding your being mind. Wise mind in this context can be especially helpful for people who find themselves lacking direction or motivation due to life circumstances such as sudden unemployment, the onset of an injury or illness, or feelings of chronic boredom. It can also be helpful for those who are busy balancing multiple roles, i.e. working and attending school, being a working parent, etc., to help with slowing down. Finding wise mind with doing and being means finding a state of flow. There is action involved and a task being performed, doing mind, and yet the person is completely present, without concern about when they complete the task or what the end result will be. Being mind. Most of the time, you probably find yourself falling too much to one side or the other, either resisting tasks that need to be done or busying yourself with a checklist of things to do. Finding a wise mind place with doing and being helps you determine what to do with your time and energy. Not only do you know when it is important to work, but you also know when it is important to play. Furthermore, sometimes work can feel like play when you are truly in your wise mind, at one with what you are doing, no matter what the activity is. Kate's tips. Much like reason mind and emotion mind, most people find they skew more towards either doing mind or being mind. I'm much more connected to my doing mind than my being mind. Sometimes the first thing I'm aware of in the morning is my brain slipping into the future to plan what I need to get done for the day. I can find it difficult to stay in the present and to let go of being goal-oriented. Doing mind. Doing mind is often the state that is seen as superior. After all, doing mind is what helps you get through school, be a good employee, stay organized, manage money, and work towards most goals you have. However, as someone who spends an imbalanced amount of my time in doing mind, I can tell you there are disadvantages as well. Too much time spent in doing mind leaves me very anxious and makes it difficult for me to relax. If you're unsure of how to tune in here, you may notice your own doing mind if you feel a sense of drive, a push to be moving forward, or a sense of being on track. Then check to see if you're feeling anxious, frantic, overwhelmed, or guilty. We all need our doing minds in order to navigate our lives, especially as adults, but too much will weigh you down and make managing your day-to-day life even more stressful. Being mind. Being mind is a space where you can contemplate your life and actions without the urge or obligation to do anything. What's the downside, you ask? Well, most of us have shit we need or want to get done. While being mind gives you a break from feeling pressured, it is also a space where you're unlikely to accomplish your goals or move forward. I often find I struggle to consciously access my being mind or allow myself to stay there for very long. The moments I'm most strongly in my being mind are when I'm out in nature. There are times when I literally stop to smell the roses or when I'm caught up unexpectedly in the beauty of a sunset or landscape. Even though those moments are fleeting, they allow me small sips of time when everything else falls away and I can simply be. Moments like those might also help you find your being mind and experience what it feels like. Knowing how it feels once will give you a better roadmap for finding it again. Wise mind. The purpose here is being effective, not being perfectly balanced. I find this state the most readily when I'm tending to my houseplants, or sometimes my garden. I get into a place of flow, where I have goals or objectives I'm working on, but without clinging to the outcomes. If you're struggling to find your wise mind here, start by finding things that you already enjoy, or naturally find yourself in a state of flow when doing. If you have a hobby or activity where you really get into the zone, that's a great place to start with this skill. Michelle's tips. Finding the balance of doing and being can feel like walking the high wire we mentioned in the pitfall sections last chapter, leaning more to one side and then the other as you go. It is completely natural in life to either do too much doing or too much being. What matters is having awareness of the impact it has on you to be in each state, and having strategies to make changes if needed. Doing mind. I live in my doing mind nearly all the time. I grew up watching my mother be in her doing mind, rarely sitting down for a moment, until she would fall asleep on the couch at the end of the day, utterly exhausted. I have a to-do list at all times in my phone, and it dictates my day from start to finish. I often fall into the trap of thinking I will feel better the more I accomplish and check off that list. The result is that I am focused on work far more than I am focused on taking care of myself. Living in my doing mind leaves me feeling accomplished, but it doesn't leave me feeling renewed or refreshed. It's become important for me to get comfortable with things being left unfinished. I have to tell myself repeatedly that things do not have to get done right now when I am too much in my doing mind. Being mind. When I am in my being mind, it feels like coming up to gasp for air before I go back to getting things done. If I find myself in being mind, it is typically very temporary and fleeting. I used to have about one day a month where I would fully live in my being mind, and it looked like sitting on the couch all day watching TV. I would only do this after having sufficiently checked off a number of things on my to-do list in the days prior, and it didn't leave me feeling as refreshed as I hoped it would. Sometimes I find myself feeling more tired when I'm in my being mind. What helps me most is making sure that I am making space for being every single day. I don't always do well at this, but it helps to just be able to take a few minutes to pause. Because I'm a morning person, it's easiest for me to take that time for myself soon after I wake up. If you're more of a night owl, it might come more naturally to make time just before bed. Wise mind. Because I spend so much time in doing mind, I need to intentionally remind myself to be. It doesn't come naturally to me, but creating space for being before doing is the way I find my wise mind. And you can do this too, if you often get stuck in doing mind. At the start of a busy day, do something just for you before you embark on your to-do list. If you were thinking about going for a walk after cleaning your house, go for a walk first. Dance around your living room for a little bit before starting a homework assignment. Don't buy into the myth that there isn't enough time. Playing before you start working will actually help you feel better, and therefore, you'll get more done when you do start to work. Pitfalls. Pitfall 1. Trying to access or spend time in your being mind can feel like being lazy and unproductive. Many people see being mind as some sort of treat or reward, something they'll give themselves once they've accomplished all their tasks. Because of that, it's common to struggle with feeling guilty. There's so much societal pressure around always doing that any time productivity isn't your main focus, it can feel like you're a failure, leading to self-judgment. If this is something you're struggling with, try to remember you can't be in your wise mind without pulling in at least some of your being mind. Being mind isn't some sort of reward either. Rather, it's a necessary component to reaching your wise mind and is no less important than your doing mind. And don't worry if you have to remind yourself of this a lot. You're fighting against years of social programming. Pitfall 2. For some folks, the idea of their being mind feels like a slippery slope. There can be this worry that if you enter a being mind state, you'll just never leave. Or at the very least, that you'll struggle to leave or to incorporate more of your doing mind. This is proof that our society puts too much emphasis on doing. If simply being feels that tempting, you're likely not doing enough of it. If you avoid your being mind too assiduously, then it can almost become a craving of sorts. This is because everyone needs some being mind in their lives, or they fall out of balance. The more you're afraid you won't leave your being mind, the more you need it. It may seem paradoxical, but deliberately incorporating more being into your life on a regular basis will make getting into your doing mind easier. You know you'll get more being time down the line, and so you won't feel the need to cling to it when you allow yourself to go there. Pitfall 3. Another common struggle is reaching or staying in doing mind. Many of the reasons you might find it difficult to engage with doing mind are fear-based. This could look like feelings of inadequacy, helplessness, fear of judgment, or a host of other issues. When you let fears keep you from taking action, you miss out on huge swathes of your life. While there is great comfort and even a sense of safety to be found in your being mind, ultimately, it is also a place of stagnancy. Comfort is necessary for a healthy and balanced life, but so is growth and achievement, neither of which is possible if you live only in your being mind. If you are someone who has to work at reaching your doing mind, try coming at it from a place of mindful awareness of your emotions. If you can identify your fears from a non-judgmental space, you can better soothe and move through those fears, instead of letting them keep you stuck. Benefits. Benefit 1. Being in a wise mind state of both doing and being increases enjoyment of activities. Think about this with eating. Do you enjoy your food more when you eat slowly and savour every bite, or when you're shoveling food in as quickly as possible? We live in a world where we tend to feel very rushed. We're so worried about arriving somewhere late that we forget to enjoy the drive to get there. We wake up in the morning and don't take time to pause before we start moving to get ready to leave the house. Slowing down often leads to paying attention in a new way to what you're doing, and that can make you appreciate what you're doing more. Benefit 2. As was mentioned in the pitfalls section, research has shown that you actually accomplish more when you allow yourself to take more breaks and just be. One example of this is recognizing that employees are more productive working 4 days a week instead of five. How can this be when they are working fewer hours? Because the balance between work and life is better. They have more time to be outside of work, so they are more refreshed when they do come into work to start doing. Working more rarely results in working more effectively and can lead to a whole host of issues, including burnout. This means, if you have a lot on your plate, one of the best things you can do for yourself is take a break to be. Benefit 3. Some people have barriers to being as physically active as they'd like to be, due to physical limitations, illness, and more. They can start to feel frustrated by the sedentary nature of their lives, and this can lead to them feeling like they are just being without any doing. Finding activities that don't require much physical effort still counts as doing, and our brains benefit from even minimal physical activity. Don't put too much pressure on yourself to be active if this is a challenge for you. Even an activity that doesn't involve much, if any, physical exertion, but does require some mental effort, can be the perfect balance of keeping an active, doing mind with a being body. Exercise. Write down your feelings and responses to the following questions. Does thinking of doing mind or being mind speak to you more or less than emotion mind or reason mind? Why or why not? What do you think will be hardest for you when it comes to doing mind or being mind? Where can you imagine this concept being useful to you in your life? How can you see yourself implementing it? Chapter 3. The what components of mindfulness. John Kabat-Zinn, the founder of mindfulness-based stress reduction, defines mindfulness as paying attention in a particular way, on purpose, in the present moment, and non-judgmentally. You will notice that sitting still and silence are not part of this definition. If you think the only way to practice mindfulness is to sit down, close your eyes, and meditate, you are incorrect. Mindfulness can be practiced in a variety of ways, both formally and informally. Formal mindfulness practices involve stopping other activities in your life and doing mindfulness. This could mean attending a yoga class, meditating, or engaging in prayer or other spiritual practices. Informal mindfulness is what we are going to be talking about as we describe the first three mindfulness skills of DBT. The other three will be discussed in the next chapter. Informal mindfulness is paying attention on purpose, like Kabat-Zinn says. Paying attention in this specific way can be done anytime, anywhere, with any activity you're doing. Increasing our awareness so we move through the world more mindfully is no small feat. We run on autopilot a lot as we go through our days. You typically don't need to pay much attention when doing tasks like brushing your teeth, drinking coffee, or getting dressed, because these are activities you've done thousands of times. On the one hand, this makes sense. On the other, it results in missing out on fully experiencing things as much as you could. Your brain starts to multitask while you're doing those easier tasks, and before you know it, your mind is somewhere else, i.e., making the grocery list, thinking about weekend plans, reflecting on an argument with a partner, etc. There are benefits to living more mindfully and drawbacks to multitasking, which we will discuss later in this chapter. For now, let's talk about the three components of mindfulness that help with paying attention on purpose in the present moment. The three what's of mindfulness. Observe. Observation is about much more than just seeing with our eyes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.